this is going to be the most powerful 5 minutes.
We're going to make it in time.
But how powerful is testimonies? I'm so glad that we are able to share hearts, isn't it? And you really don't understand the power of what God's doing in someone's life, and it's powerful. Overcoming by the word of your testimony. Awesome. Well, I just really wanted to share a couple of ideas and a scripture or two, and really round off this series on inheriting the promises, if that's okay. Anybody still want the Lord, still want the word? Amen. If you want to just turn to Luke 14. Hallelujah. Luke 14, verse 25. Tonight's short 5-minute message is maybe 15 is called the Marinate of the Holy Spirit. Sounds good. The Marinate of the Holy Spirit. Okay, I'm going to read this passage in the Amplified because I love it in the Amplified, and we're kind of moving forward. Not the whole of Luke 14. I'm going to speed read. Yeah, let's just read scripture. That'll be it. Okay, verse 25. Now large crowds were going along with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life, in the sense of indifference to or relative disregard for them in comparison with his attitude toward God," love the Amplified, "he cannot be my disciple." Verse 27, "Whoever does not carry his own cross, expressing a willingness to endure," everyone say endure, "to endure whatever may come, and follow after me, believing in me, conforming to my example in living, and if need be, suffering." We had some words about the suffering of Christ tonight, wasn't it? "If need be, suffering or perhaps dying because of faith in me," God speaking, "cannot be my disciple." Verse 28, "For which one of you, when he wants to build a watchtower for his guards, does not first sit down and calculate the cost to see if he has enough to finish it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is unable to finish the building, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This man began to build and was not able to finish.'" Verse 31, "Or what king, when he sets out to meet another king in battle, will not first sit down and consider whether he is strong enough with 10,000 men to encounter the one who is coming against him with 20,000. Verse 33, skip down. "So then, none of you can be my disciple who does not carefully consider the cost, and then for my sake give up all his own possessions. Therefore," and this is the important bit I want to bring out, "salt is good." Everyone say salt is good. "Salt is good, but if salt has become tasteless, with what will it be seasoned? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It is thrown away. He who has ears to hear, let him hear and heed my words." Anyone's got ears to hear? Touch your ears tonight. Lord, open our spiritual ears to hear tonight this speedy 5-minute word. Lord. Salt is good. Amen. You know, there's a lot about salt in the Bible. And I love this passage because it's the key passage about the saltiness of the Lord. You know, in Psalm 38 it says, "Taste and see that the Lord is good." And we've been talking about that in school. By the way, this Tuesday night is the last night for the term. Beg, borrow, climb over whatever obstacle, just get there if you can, because it's going to be the finale, okay? So if you, unless, you know, by death you can't make it or something, please come. I believe God's going to do something powerful. We're going to bring come to a culmination, all of this teaching and what we've been talking about pre-worship, this interweaves and into all of it, what we're talking about tonight. But salt is good. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good. We've been talking in this school that scripture in Psalm 34 is sandwiched between the angel of the Lord and camps around those who fear Him, who reverentially worship Him. It's sandwiched between verses about the fear of the Lord. So God wants us to taste and see. Now, it's interesting, this is taste first. He wants us to taste the saltiness of the Lord. I believe that that's what God wants us to do. And that's what we're called to do here as a fellowship. First you taste the saltiness, then you can see that the Lord is good. And then the Amplified goes on to say, to be envied, to be blessed is the one who takes refuge in Him, who dwells in Him. It's a powerful, powerful scripture. Taste first the saltiness. We just read about the saltiness of the Lord. And then you're going to see. Then you're going to know Him. Right? And I want to really wrap this up in a nutshell. We need the saltiness. We need to be salty. And the scripture here is clear. What is that saltiness? If any man cannot give up mother, father, sister, brother, even your own life. This is true. He's talking about that tonight. Every other idol, every other god, every other thing that gets in the way of us putting God absolutely first. You can't give it up. It's an idol. It commands you. It has power over you. God is saying, you need to be salty. You cannot be salty without this. You need to count the cost. And this is what happens in the church. It becomes bland. Bland teaching. Bland social events. This is not preached. And what happens? You lose your saltiness. What does the word say? You'll be thrown out. You'll be trampled by men. We're moving into the term of spiritual warfare and victory. I'm talking about how you can have victory. It comes down to this saltiness. What else does it say in that scripture? It's not even good for throwing the manure on the soil. Why was God saying that? Because salt was used to prepare the soil. It was used as a fertilizer in the days of the Bible to prepare the soil for the seed. And I want to tell you that God is preparing us at the moment. This stretching is a preparation. This saltiness is what He's bringing us to, because that saltiness in your heart, that God, I will put you first, even my own life doesn't count. I will give it up for you. That's the saltiness that prepares, that throws up the soil of the heart to receive the true seed, the true word of Jesus, the true gospel. I can tell you, as a Bible teacher in a school of ministry, I've taught for years and I've seen people receive the seed, and I've seen people sit for years under teaching and never receive seed. Never let this saltiness come into their heart. There's no seed going in there. It's hard. Your heart is hard. I can preach to you this forever and a day, and it won't go in because you haven't come to this place of saltiness. You haven't bowed. You haven't become a true worshiper. You haven't said, God, even father, mother, sister, brother, even my own life. This is the gospel in a nutshell. Amen. This is the saltiness of Jesus. Taste and see how salty God is. This is what He's looking for. And He wants to taste the saltiness back in the church. He wants to be salty for Him. You know, yesterday we had a family day out. And we went to Chinatown. And it was rainy and it was cold. And so the first thing on my mind is, oh, I've got this appetite for good Vietnamese fur. You know, I love a good fur in winter, not the F-U-R. The P-H-O fur, right? And I had this craving. I was thinking, oh, I could do with a good fur. And, you know, Chris wasn't well, and I hadn't been well. And we think, oh, it'd be really good for us too, but, oh, that fur. And so we went to this Vietnamese spot we've been to on a date day. And it's awesome. If anybody wants good fur, I can tell you where to go. It was in Chinatown, and the kids loved it as well, and drinking this beautiful bone broth fur, and it's like, oh, it's cold outside, this bowl of goodness, and I thought, oh, I like to make this, you know, so I start researching into it. We're talking about the saltiness, right, okay, this beautiful stock. Now, a master fur, a master stock, I was reading, it says that you can cook it at home. But there are secrets, and it said in the internet article I was reading, the best fur comes from a Vietnamese grandma, and so it's handed down over generations, and there are secrets to making the right one. Would you like to know some of the secrets? Because I believe God's speaking to us about the tastiness, the saltiness, right? And it says you can cook it at home, and you can do a decent version of, you know, an hour and a half of boiling, an hour and a half of cooking. You'll get an okay fur. But if you're willing to let it cook longer, 3 or 4 hours, better fur. But if you want a restaurant quality fur, you're going to have to look at 12 hours or more. Solid, low and slow cooking, right? 12 hours and 12 apostolic. So that restaurant quality fur is like 12 hours and 11. Lots of love has gone into that. There's layers of flavor. The other thing I've talked about was, you know, from this Vietnamese grandma, try open flame cooking the ginger and the onion. So don't just, you know, chuck it in a pot. Take some care. Get an open flame, that smoky flavor comes out from an open flame cooking. Onion and ginger. Cook that up and then put that in the stock. Then take your aromatics, and this just adds more and more flavor. Take your aromatics like, oh, these foodies are going to be all salivating. We want fur after this. We want dinner now. Go to Vietnamese after this. But that fur, to make it even more powerful in flavor, that extra layer, take the aromatics like the star of anise and the cloves and dry roast it in a pan over heat. Bring out Lenny, the beautiful Indian curry. Cook is saying, yes, amen. You dry roast these aromatics, and then you put that in, and then you cook it for 12 solid hours, low and slow. Now, the thing about a curry is you have to cook it low and slow. If you get impatient and you turn up the heat and you want it fast, it's going to burn it. It's not going to get tender. It's not going to break down. You need some breaking down in our hearts, don't we? It's not going to have that flavor. It's going to burn. It's going to get bitter. Right? Unpalatable, tasteless, only good for throwing away. God's speaking to us about his ways, isn't he? Taste and see the saltiness. When God is going to take you, we're talking about inheriting the promises. God is going to take you through that process of low and slow to bring this saltiness in you. You're going to have to believe what we were singing. Because he is the Alpha and the Omega. He begins and he says, thus saith the Lord, this is what I'm going to do. Then he brings you through a process where are you, God? And then, Omega, there you are. That's how he operates. That's how he works. It's between the Alpha and the Omega that counts. What does the word say? Through faith and patience, you inherit the promises. two have to go together. You know, I have fond memories of watching my mum. I love how he passed down recipes over generations. And I have this beautiful book of all the recipes my mum has written down. I love being Asian. I love the marinades and the tastiness. You know, Chris grew up English, and so, you know, most of English food is boiling things with a life, you know, with no life left in it, right? Yeah, all the nutrients, like, seep out and it goes down the sink. And so when he came over my house, because I was still, you know, we were courting, and my mum would cook up these Asian meals, you know, Southeast Malaysian curries and stuff, and Chris just always happened to come around. And it was like, oh, I'm going to be getting these meals when we get married. You'll do know that. I had to learn the hard way how to cook. But thankfully, the yeah, that's a whole other message. Faith and patience. The promises. But thankfully, my mum had detailed down all of these precious recipes, and they're so precious to me. And one of the sections of that is marinades. We're talking about the marinating of the Holy Spirit. I had these fond memories of watching my mum, because she worked full time all during my schooling years, and in the morning she'd get up early and she would marinate the meat. So they would marinate over the whole day, what, like 8 hours, 9 hours, and then at the end of the day she's got this beautiful, succulent, tender, tasty, salty, you know, the soy sauce and the hoisin sauce and these particular marinades. And what does a marinade do? It makes it salty and tasty, so it actually becomes part of the meat. But also it tenderizes, doesn't it? What does that mean? It tenderizes and breaks down all those sinews, all those hard bits in the meat that need to be tenderized. And Adam, you prayed tonight when we were praying as a worship team, Lord, give us a tender heart. And then in the Spirit, God is tenderizing. What does He need to break down? What does He need to tenderize? All those things in us that we think are strong. And I think that's been really the theme that He's been speaking, hasn't He? I thought that I was strong. I thought I had that ability. I thought I had that strength. He will bring you to a place of absolute weakness. Because it's only when we're weak, He is strong. Anybody want God to be strong? Then you've got to be weak. You've got to let that marinade break down all the things in our heart that are sinewy, that are tough, that we thought we relied on, that were strong in our own strength. And you've got to become weak and tender and soft and broken even before the Lord. That is what this process, the marinade of the Holy Spirit, will do. It's a good place. I can tell you, I have wanted to give up many, many times. But that's a good place. I'm not going to give in to that. It's a good place because then I have to give up so that He can be my strength, right? I can do nothing without Him. I can't do Fireplace without You. I can't even preach a word without You. I can't worship without You. I can't do it. I can't have a good marriage without You. God spoke, right? He will bring you to utter, utter weakness. And it is good. I want to marinate. You've got to learn how to marinate. You've got to love the marinade. And end on this, you know, once I was waiting on the Lord in the bath. I was in the bathtub. The Lord often speaks to me in the bathtub as a place of rest. And I had a visitation. And St. Esther walked in the door again. And she started talking to me about this process, this marinade. Now, the thing about Esther was before she went to see the king, what did she do? She had to soak. And one of the the things that she said to me. She said many things, but one of them that just, oh Lord, because she's one that fulfilled the promises. She's a, one of the ones who inherit. And I want to find out how you did it. And she said to me one thing that stuck in my heart. She said, learn to soak. Learn to marinate. Because she had to soak in that tub for 12 months after soak again, right? She had to let that fragrance become a part of her, enter into her skin. That only came through time. That only came through low and slow. But she had to learn how to soak and marinate. In the midst of danger, in the midst of trial, in the midst of hardship. So this is the key. Marinating in His presence. Giving in to the process. Awesome. Let's stand on our feet. I'm going to extend in the time of prayer. That greater depth of flavor, that saltiness that comes with that fur. Just a few quick details. You know, that saltiness, that nutrient comes from the marrow and the bone breaking down. It comes from the cartilage and the things that were tough breaking down. And you can see the Lord doing that in us. It's a good, good thing. You know what happens when that breaks down? This beautiful, great depth of flavor comes forth, and it's not just tasty and salty, it's incredibly nutrient filled. You know, that bone broth is now, scientists have proven that you drink of that, that can help with diabetes, that can help with joint health, that can help with immunity, of course, that can help you stave away heart disease. It's a good thing, that depth of flavor, that level of nutrients that comes from low and slow. So thank you, Father, for your ways. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We want to inherit in the end, but before that, we want to be able to enjoy even the process of marinating, the process of low and slow cooking. We want to be salty. So Lord, I pray that you would establish every heart tonight. A fresh resolve. An ability to decide to take your true gospel, to be salty once more. I don't want to be bland. I don't want to be tasteless. I want to taste and see the Lord. So I bless each one tonight with that extra tastiness, that incessant hunger that we will not be satiated except by you. Our mouths are watering for you, Jesus. Make us salty again, Lord Jesus. Even in the circumcision of heart tonight, to those who are willing, and you can respond to the Lord in your own heart tonight. He sees and He knows. Let us never be the same. I want to be salty in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to invite John, just to lead us in.